Well, good morning, church family. Good morning to all of you who tune in today's Zoom service. Today is August the 9th, and praise God that we are once again gathered together via Zoom and together in praising God, together in worshiping God this wonderful day, that indeed this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Before we start anything else, I'd like to read this portion of Psalms 105. Let me just read this to all of you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon His name. Make known His deeds among the peoples. Sing to Him. Sing psalms to Him. Talk of all His wondrous works. Glory in His holy name. Let the hearts of those rejoice who seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and His strength. Seek His face forevermore. Remember His marvelous works which He has done, His wonders in the judgment of His mouth. Praise God. Praise God. Again, once again, welcome to all of you. And let's just prepare our hearts and mind and be ready to worship the living Savior. And before we proceed, of course, let's just proceed with our announcement. Tita Lo, do you have the announcement for next Sunday, for the coming week? So for I don't know if you saw my email last week. I sent an email to all the parents of our Sunday school children. We are offering a virtual BBS for ages 5 to 10 years old. This will be tomorrow, actually, starting tomorrow, the whole week of tomorrow, Monday to Friday, and the link is www.intothecastle.com/BBS. This is from Yes TV and the Crossroad Ministry that is offering to us for free. So if you are interested in for your children to attend this virtual BBS, please register online. Also, at least this week, we have some activities for children to know more about Jesus and that they will be able to grow more in the knowledge of God. So again, you need to register yourself into this link that is that you are seeing in the screen. And also to remind you that I already sent this by email. For our midweek service, Wednesday, August the 12th at 7 p.m., our exhorter is Sister Phyllis Hussein. So if you have any prayer requests, please call or email myself or text me so that we can write your prayer requests and we will be praying for it on Wednesday. And for those of you who are available, you can join us in our midweek gathering via Zoom. For Sunday service, which is August the 16th, 10 a.m., our congregational prayer will be led by our dear sister, Belle Mendoza. So, Sister Belle, you will be leading the congregational prayer. Brother Mike, would you remind her if she's not yet tuned in? Our worship leader will be Sister Richie and Akemi, mother and daughter. Praise God. And prayer for offering will be Brother Anel, and I will be preaching God's word, and I will also be doing the benediction. Wow, praise the Lord. Again, welcome everybody. And let's just now turn into Sister Lou. She will be doing the congregational prayer this morning. Tita Lou, take it away.
Hey, good morning, brothers and sisters. Hope all is well with you all and with the family. Today is already our 21st Sunday, or fifth month, worshiping together virtually. Praise the Lord, no? Praise the Lord that we are here safe and protected from the virus. Truly, our God that we worship is faithful, merciful, and loving. Though the pandemic is still here, we see hope and God is working for our good and our benefit. As we see now the reopening of businesses, entertainment, sports, restaurants, and a lot more, and soon all schools. But hopefully, whatever we have learned from this pandemic, we will never forget. Like during the lockdown, we only depended on God. Got closer to Him. We trust Him. We trusted Him. Some turned to our Lord Jesus. Some renewed their relationship with Him. For some, they got closer or reconciled with their family and children. and there could be more lessons learned. But let us continue seeking who God is and be focused on Him alone, and or as He alone can do miracles in this world, and He alone can make all things right. Now, even in the midst of this global crisis, we will not run out of reasons to thank the Lord and praise Him because He is good. Let us always remember the benefits we receive from Him, or just like what I just heard from a preaching this morning, let us not waste the good lessons we learned from this crisis. David, Psalm 103, one of the popular Psalms, confirmed this. Now, let us read it together with conviction. I'm going to share my screen to you, if you don't have your Bible with you. Okay, let's all read. Praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being, praise His holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases? Who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion? Who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles? The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known His ways to Moses, His deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will He harbor His anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His love for those who fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear Him. For He knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear Him, and His righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep His covenant and remember to obey His precepts. The Lord has established His throne in heaven, and His kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you His angels, you mighty ones who do His bidding, who obey His word. Praise the Lord, all His heavenly hosts, you His servants who do His will. Praise the Lord, all His works everywhere in His dominion. Praise the Lord, my soul. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You. We praise You and we worship You, for You alone is worthy. Father, thank You for Your word through the Psalm of David to remind us of what You have done in the past, how You rescued us, delivered us, healed us, provided for us, protected us, and how You loved us, especially during this pandemic. Father, may we always remember Your faithfulness in our daily lives, so whenever we go through anything, we are comforted that You will help us, for You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And You will never leave us nor forsake us. Thank You, Father. Praise Your holy name. And today, O Lord, I lift up everyone to You and every part of the service, that Your name may be glorified. But more especially, the preaching of Your word. May You anoint our pastor to deliver Your word with simplicity and clarity, but with power. I pray that You will meet every need of each soul today through him. Father, open our spiritual eyes and ears so nothing and no one will miss Your message, but rather receive it and apply it in our daily Christian walk. I pray that the Holy Spirit will constantly remind us of who You are, of what You have done, of what You have given us, so that, Father, we may respond to Your love by abiding in Your word, to trust in You alone, and to continue doing good works that only You will be pleased and glorified. Father, once again, thank You for Your goodness. We praise You and give You all the glory in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And everyone said, amen.
Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Tita Lou. Praise God. And now, prepare our hearts to worship as I will be calling Tofi and Kyla to lead us into worship this morning. Take it away, Tofi and Kyla.
Hi, good morning, everybody. I hope everybody's has a blessed week. As usual, we have missed you all. And as we worship today, let's just keep our hearts closer to God and let Him speak to us in these times of trouble, and let us find comfort in Him, that knowing that, you know, our God never wastes or loses a battle. He always wins it, and there's always a purpose for everything that He does. Amen. So let's just come together and worship God, and let's just pour out our hearts to Him and tell Him how much we need Him in this time.
The all-creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in a resurrection, that He will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus, our judge and our defender, suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in a resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. And I believe in you. Jesus Christ is Lord, and I believe in you, and I believe you rose again, and I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in life eternal. I believe in a virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in a resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the Holy Spirit, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah, Lord God. Yes, Lord, we sing Hosanna in the highest, O God, Lord. Hosanna to the King of Kings. Hosanna to the Lord of Lords, O God, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise be to you, Jesus, O God. Indeed, Lord, you alone deserves the glory. You alone deserves the thanksgiving. You alone deserves our worship, O God, Lord. Hallelujah. We lift up your holy name on high, Jesus, O God, Lord. You are the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, O God, the author and perfecter of our faith, O God, Lord. You are our Savior, our Redeemer, our power, our strength, our life, oh God, apart from you, we're nothing, oh God, Lord Jesus, that we live and move and have our being because of you, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Today, oh God, we come to you, oh God, Lord. Oh God, Lord, with faith in you, oh God, knowing and believing that your presence is with us, oh God, in the power of the Holy Spirit, oh God, Lord, that everything that we will do today will be led by your Spirit, because it's not by might, it's not by power, but by your Spirit alone, oh God, Lord. Father, we thank you for the life of Tophie and Kyla, oh God, whom we have used today, oh God, Lord, to worship you in spirit and in truth, Lord. Thank you for your people who came today, oh God, to worship you, God, to glorify your name. Thank you for Titalo, whom we have used today to open up our gathering through this congregational prayer, oh God, Lord, reminding us of Psalms 103, oh God, that we should never, never forget all the benefits, oh God, that we are receiving from you, especially in this time of pandemic, because you are faithful, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord God. Lord, we just commit to you the rest of this service, oh God, today. Again, Lord, Holy Spirit, lead us, guide us, oh God, Lord, in everything that we will do, oh God, Lord. Give you back all glory, honor, praise. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. And again, welcome everybody, those who just tune in. Praise God. And we welcome you in today's Zoom service. And so before we proceed with the Word of God, let's call Brother Mike, who will be leading the prayer for the offering. Brother Mike.
Thank you, Pastor Rick. Praise God. Beloved in the Lord, good morning. 2 Samuel 24, verse 24. You know this verse pretty well. David asserts, I will not give to God anything that costs me what? Nothing. Let's say it all together. I will not give to God anything that costs me nothing. Friends, isn't it every time we give a present to someone that we care, someone we love, a friend or a family, we make it sure that it's something that we give, something that's important, something that's precious, something that's significant, something that has a great value. Because of this, then we know that the recipient would receive our present joyfully and thankfully. Isn't it right? Our Lord God has given us His very best gift, His own Son, Jesus Christ. And so this morning, let me encourage you. Let's have that attitude of gratitude. Pastor Rick just mentioned Psalm 103. Don't forget the benefit we receive from the Lord. It's countless. It's grace. It's abundant. Let's not forget. So this morning, I would like to encourage you. Let's give back to the Lord with all of our hearts. Amen, church. Now let's join our hearts together in prayer. Father, we praise you for who you are in our lives. We thank you for the privilege that we could come once again together and give a portion of the blessings of the grace that you have given us. Now we give you back these funds, these blessings. May these gifts be acceptable to you, Father God, and may we glorify you, may we lift your name on high, because you alone deserve all of the blessings and the glory. And we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Everyone says amen, amen, and amen.
Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, again, I would say as the love offering ushers going around. Yeah, I forgot about that there's no one is going around, but you can give your offering to the Lord through Tithely. And as it's always being announced, you can still write a check and just make an arrangement with our treasurer sister, Tess David, so she can either pick it up from your place or you can drop off at their house. So again, thank you for all your support, financial support, financial sacrifices. In the midst of the pandemic, you are still able to support the works of God through Be Alive Christian Fellowship. And as you are still maybe doing your online giving or writing a check, let's just again welcome everybody. Welcome to all of you who just tune in our Sunday service. So we will proceed now with our word, the word of God. And today is the second Sunday of August, and believe it or not, we're on our 22nd Sunday. I think I miscounted, or Sister Lou miscounted. She said 21st Sunday, but I thought it's 22nd Sunday of gathering via Zoom. But again, praise the Lord. We have to be thankful to the Lord that God has provided us this wonderful, wonderful technology so that we can continue seeing each other and we can hear God's word together remotely. And if you were here last Sunday, I'm sure you can agree with me that we had a wonderful treat from the Lord, as He has blessed us so much with His presence through our young people who led the service from the beginning to the end. God is indeed good and faithful to our church. He's already preparing the next generation of leaders, worshipers, and preachers. As CJ shared, the youth ministry leaders are so pleased and blessed seeing the growth of the group. Praise God. Praise God. And so today, I will begin a short series of two parts preaching that will deal with God's covenant to His own people. And I'm talking about the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And I'm sure these terms are not new to your ears, as we've been hearing this all the time, especially during communion, when Jesus said, "This is the new covenant in my blood." And as the word new covenant implies, if Jesus talks of a new covenant, then it means there's an old covenant. There's been a lot of misunderstanding and question about these two covenants, such as, what are the differences between the two? Which one are we supposed to obey and adhere to? Are we part of the old? Are we part of the new covenant? Or are we part of both? Why God replaced the old with the new? Did God make mistakes with the first one that He needed to make a new one? What was wrong with the old covenant? And so before I proceed, let me just share to you my screen. Okay, so the title of my preach is simply straightforward, The Old Covenant. So the outline that I have for today are this. What is a covenant? Why is there a need for a covenant? What are the major covenants in the scripture? And lastly, why the Old Covenant was put aside? You know, like I said, there are so many questions that being asked or being raised, or there's a lot of misunderstanding about the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And so my goal today is we will try to answer some of those questions, if not all, so that we will have an understanding with both Old and the New Covenants. And these are very broad topic to talk about in a preaching setting. So we will try to pick up the most that we can as we go along. So again, here's the outline of our preaching today. What is a covenant? Why is there a need for a covenant? What are the major covenants in the scripture? Why the old covenant was put aside? I would like to ask you to read with me our passage for today from Exodus 19, verses 3 to 6. Exodus 19, verses 3 to 6. Again, if you don't have your Bible, it's on the screen. You just follow along. Let's read all together. Exodus 19, verses 3 to 6. And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be a kingdom of priests and holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak to the children of Israel." Let us pray. Father God, Lord, thank you for today, And once again, we thank you, O God, that we can gather together to listen to your word. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence, O God, Lord. And we ask you now to lead us and guide us in understanding what you want us to understand from your word. I ask, Lord, that you hide me in your presence, O God, Lord, that they will not see me, but see you, that they will not hear me, but hear you, O God, Lord. These are all your words, and I am your vessel, O God, Lord. Use me, O God, Lord, for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. So, let's jump in right into our point number one. Point number one, of course, is what is a covenant? What is a covenant? The English word definition of the word covenant is this: an agreement, usually formal, between two or more persons to do or not to do something specified. Something specified. For example, a marriage covenant between man and wife. Also, a business partnership between two or more parties is a covenant. Its party is committed to do whatever is stipulated in their treaty or agreement. In the case of a man and a wife, their covenant is for better or for worse, in sickness or in health, till death do them part. Now, going back to the original text of the scripture, the Hebrew word for the covenant is berit, berit, which is also defined as an agreement, a contract, and a treaty between two parties, and it also means partnership. Berit is also defined as the Jewish rite of circumcision, meaning to cut the flesh. That is why we read from other Bible versions saying, God cut the covenant with Abraham. That means there's a blood involved in the covenant agreement. And that's why in the new covenant, Jesus shed his blood to ratify the new covenant with his people, to the believers. So by these definitions, we can appreciate that a biblical covenant is between God and his people, Israel. God is the God of covenant. He is the sovereign administrator of covenants. He initiated the covenant between him and his own people. And not only he is the covenant maker, but he is also a covenant keeper. And there are two categories or basic types of covenants, namely conditional or bilateral covenants, or the unconditional or unilateral covenants. What are those? What are those? An unconditional or unilateral covenant is a promise made by God that the other party need not to do anything to fulfill what was promised. Let me repeat. An unconditional or unilateral covenant is a promise made by God that the other party need not do anything to fulfill what was promised. While a conditional or bilateral covenant is a binding agreement between two parties, and as such, it has some stipulations or do's and don'ts between the two parties. It means both parties agree to fulfill certain conditions. If neither party fails to meet the responsibility, the covenant is broken. So when we speak of biblical covenants, we are referring to instances where God has entered into an agreement with mankind that involves both promises and responsibilities. Let's look back in the Garden of Eden. Beginning in the Garden of Eden, when God created Adam and Eve in Genesis 1, he then blessed them. God blessed them. And that's God's end of the deal always. His intention is to bless people. His intention is to protect people. His intention is to provide for people. God blessed them. That's God's end of the deal. And here's man's end of the deal. When he said to Adam and Eve, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And with Adam, God specifically gave him the instruction to tend and keep the garden as recorded in Genesis 2:15. To me, it sounds like easy task to obey both for Adam and Eve, but we all know the story how it turned out with both of them. And that was the covenant God made with Adam and Eve. Now, point number two. Why is there a need for a covenant? Why is there a need for a covenant? One of the main ideas that we see throughout the Bible are covenants. Covenants are not exactly contracts that we, the way we think contracts today, though there are some similarities. A covenant is essentially a relationship. Again, in the Garden of Eden, God initiated the relationship with Adam and Eve. That's the reason why he created them. A covenant is a relationship that has been formalized and has been brought under sanctions or rules. Isn't it that in any relationship, it always comes with agreement? For example, for a boyfriend and a girlfriend, that's a relationship. And they have some kind of understanding. They have some kind of agreement. There are blessings that come if the relationship is kept, and there are penalties that come if the relationship is broken. And the covenant is simply the terms of that relationship. Historians say that covenants were common practice between nations, between native tribes, and between people in Africa and in the Arab nation, Syria, and even during the ancient Near East culture. Even from the Philippine history, I don't know if you remember this, the famous blood compact between Datu Sikatuna and General Miguel Legazpi in March 16, 1565. You know, the blood compact, the Sikatuna wants to establish friendship with Spain. That's why they initiated this blood compact. And there were three reasons why they cut a covenant between each other. Three reasons why they cut covenant with each other. Number one, if a strong tribe lives by the side of a weaker tribe, there is a danger of the weaker tribe being destroyed. The weaker tribe will seek to cut a covenant with the stronger tribe so that they will be preserved. Let me repeat. Reason number one, if a strong tribe lives by the side of the weaker tribe, there's a danger of the weaker tribe being destroyed. The weaker tribe will seek to cut a covenant with the stronger tribe so that they may be preserved. Reason number two, two businessmen entering into a partnership might cut the covenant to ensure that neither would take advantage of the other. And reason number three, if two people love each other, they would cut a covenant for that love's sake. See here, little that they knew, talking about this primitive covenant, entering into covenant, little that they knew, their blood covenant practices were according to the biblical practice of cutting the covenant. God is the mightier and stronger of two parties, and yet he initiated to cut the covenant with the weaker one, first to Adam, and then to Abram, and then to Noah, and then to Moses, and to David. The stronger, who is God, sought the covenant with the weaker. And we all know that God was not a threat to anyone. Instead, he is a blessing to all. And we all know that God will never take advantage of anyone, but instead he wants to be the protector, the provider, and the preserver of his people. And we also know that God loves his people, and for that love's sake, he initiated to cut the covenant with them. And again, God was not a threat to the weaker one. He chose to be a friend to them. He chose to be an ally to them, and that's why God chose to cut a covenant with them. God will never take advantage of them. Instead, He wants to bless them. God wants a relationship with His creation. He wants to partner with them. He wants to bless and love them. Everything that God does is based on covenant. God expresses His love for His people through the covenant He made from the beginning of time. And the stipulations in the covenant are the means on how people will reciprocate to the love of their Jehovah God. And so by our definition, we can also say that covenant is a partnership. A partnership. Partnership is another facet of our relationship with God. God wants partnership with man when He created Adam and Eve. In the Garden of Eden, God wants Adam and Eve to be His partners in expressing His love and goodness to the earth He created. Unfortunately, Adam and Eve broke that partnership with God, which resulted to them being separated from God and evicted from the garden. And as a result also, you and I are stuck with the fallen and corrupted world in which we live because of the broken relationship, broken covenant between God and Adam. But for God, I love this phrase, but God, in His nature of love and forgiveness, took the first step in repairing the covenant by selecting a small group of people and make a new covenant with them. So why is there a need for a covenant? To have some rules of engagement. I know rules of engagement is a military term, but we can also use this as the reason why there's a need for covenant is for rules of engagement. God establishes covenant with man to have the rules of engagement so that man can know God's promises, man can know God's plans, purposes, and that man can experience His power and His providence over His creation, and so that man can reciprocate to this love God has for them. After the fall, God reinstated and reestablished His covenant as a way of repairing the broken relationship between God and man. Now, why is there a need for covenant? The very purpose of the covenant is restoration and redemption. Restoration and redemption. Point number three. What are the major covenants in the scripture? Now, let's see what are the major covenants Jehovah God made with His people in chronological order. And please take note that one thing common about these covenants was that they are all restorative and redemptive in nature. And all of this took place after the fall of Adam and Eve. Number one is the Noahic covenant. This is between Jehovah and Noah, as recorded in Genesis 9. After having sent a global flood to destroy the wickedness that had become so prevalent on earth, God promised Noah and all humanity to never again destroy the world with a flood. This covenant is an unconditional covenant because it does not depend upon anything Noah or his descendants had to do to fulfill the covenant. The promise is based only upon God's faithfulness. And because of God's faithfulness to always do what He says He will do, we can know today with certainty that there will never be another worldwide flood as there was in the days of Noah. No matter how wicked mankind becomes, neither the wickedness nor the righteousness of mankind will affect or dictate the fulfillment of God's promise in this covenant. What's the next major covenant in Scripture is the Abrahamic covenant, and this is between Jehovah and Abraham, as recorded in Genesis 12. Years after the flood, sin and pride led the people to rebel against God. They even attempted to reach heaven on their own way by constructing the Tower of Babel. After having them dispersed by confusing their language, God would eventually choose one man and one nation, a pagan from the land of Ur, as the instrument of his blessing to the entire world. God chose Abram to cut a covenant with him. And as a sign of this covenant, Abram has been changed to Abraham, and Sarai was changed to Sarah. And the covenant was sealed by the circumcision of every male in Israel. And there was the blood involved again in the cutting of the covenant between God and Abraham. The Abrahamic covenant is the basis of Judaism and Christianity, and that it was the reason for Israel's becoming a nation and the Israelites becoming the people of God. This covenant, this Abrahamic covenant, is an unconditional covenant, as God said to Abraham, "I will make you a great nation. I will lead you to the promised land. I will bless the earth through you." God said, I will, and I will. This covenant bounds Abraham and his descendants by indissoluble ties to Jehovah. And it bounds Jehovah to Abraham and his descendants by the same solemn token. And also because of this covenant, God was under obligation to shield them from the armies of the nations that surrounded them. That means God's protection will always be upon them. That God was under the obligation to see that their land brought forth large crops and harvest. And it speaks about God's provision for them. And that God was under the obligation to see that the herds and flocks multiplied. That speaks about preservation and prosperity for the people of God. And also in this Abrahamic covenant, the hand of God was upon them in blessing. They became the head of the nation and of wealth. Jerusalem became the richest city in the world has ever known. And there was no city like it. And why? Because Jehovah was their God, and they were God's covenant people. No wonder why you see Jewish people always prospering wherever they are, whether they are in North America, they are in Africa, they are in Asia. You see them prospering because God was their God. Jehovah was their God, and they are God's covenant people. The third major covenant is the Mosaic covenant recorded in Exodus chapter 19 to chapter 24. And this is between Jehovah and Moses. Following the narratives of the Israelites, though they were God's covenant people, they were also known for breaking the covenant by being rebellious and disobedient to their Jehovah. In spite of that, God was faithful and true to them. As a consequence of their rebellion, God allowed them to become slaves in Egypt. And he comes again, but God, who is true to his promise of deliverance, but God, who is always faithful in fulfilling his part of the covenant, but God, who is bound to his promises to Abraham, he sent Moses to deliver them out of Egypt. Now, fast forward to reaching Mount Sinai. Through Moses, God reinstated his covenant with the Israelites, and this is now called the Mosaic Covenant. And from our passage, Exodus 19, 5 to 6, reading it again, he said, "Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people. For all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak to the children of Israel." So God gave the law to his servant Moses at Mount Sinai, and thus making the Mosaic Covenant centered on God's divine law. And that's why many Bible scholars say that the law is almost synonymous to the covenant. we cannot separate the Mosaic Covenant from the Torah. The Mosaic Covenant is a conditional covenant or a bilateral covenant as God expects his people to be obedient to his law. As we see in Exodus 19:5, and the people agreed to the covenant when they said in Exodus 19:8, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do. All that the Lord has spoken, we will do. And we also know how it turned out with Israelite with the promise of obedience. And in this Mosaic covenant, we will also read about the blessings of disobedience and the blessing of obedience to the law as recorded in Deuteronomy 28. The Mosaic Covenant is significant in both God's redemptive history toward his people and the history of the nation of Israel, through whom God would sovereignly choose to bless the world with both his written word and the living word, who is Jesus Christ. Next Sunday, we will talk about the New Covenant. When we talk about the New Covenant, we will find out more how the Mosaic Covenant is significantly important to having the New Covenant and why Jesus Christ has to come. What is the fourth major covenant? It is the Davidic Covenant, as recorded in 2 Samuel 7. It is the covenant between Jehovah and King David. After the people disobeyed, notice this, after the people disobeyed again, they disobeyed again the commands of God gave in the Mosaic Covenant. That God gave, God made the Davidic Covenant as a means to bring them back into relationship with Jehovah. Again, let's read the 2 Samuel 7, 12 to 16. It reads, when your days are fulfilled and you rest with your fathers, I will set up your seed after you, who will come from your body, and I will establish this his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he shall be my son. If he commits iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of man and with the blows of the son of man. But my mercy shall not depart from him. And as I took it from Saul, whom I removed from before you, and your house and your kingdom shall be established forever before you. Your throne shall be established forever. And of course, we know that this is referring to the son of David, Solomon. But this covenant is made between God and King David, which God promises David and Israel that the Messiah, Jesus Christ, would come from his lineage. And God, through David, would establish a kingdom that would endure forever. The Davidic covenant is an unconditional covenant because God does not place any conditions of obedience upon its fulfillment. The surety of the promises made rest solely on God's faithfulness and does not depend at all on David or Israel's obedience. Brothers and sisters, obviously there's so much more to learn from each of the covenant God made with the people through the history of the nation of Israel. But for now, let's leave it at that. And let's proceed to point number 4. Why the old covenant was put aside? Why the old covenant was put aside? This is getting a lot more interesting, doesn't it? And here's some question we raised earlier that we will try to answer. Why did God replace the old with the new? Did God make mistake with the first one that he needed to make a new one? What was wrong with the old covenant? To answer this question, let's turn our Bible into Hebrews, the book of Hebrews, beginning chapter 8, beginning from 7 to 13. Hebrews chapter 8, beginning 7 to 13. Read alongside with me. For if there had been nothing wrong with that first covenant, no place would have been sought for another. But God found fault with the people and said, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they did not remain faithful to my covenant. And I turn away from them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will establish with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my laws in their minds and write them in their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbors or to say to one another, 'Know the Lord,' because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. For I will forgive their wickedness and I will remember their sins no more. By calling this covenant new, he has made the first one obsolete, and what is obsolete and outdated will soon disappear." We soon disappear. The context of Hebrews 8 is about Jesus Christ being our high priest. The writer is making a comparison to the high priest according to the Mosaic covenant, being inferior in all things to Jesus Christ as our high priest, who is now seated in his heavenly throne. The Mosaic high priest offered gifts and sacrifices in behalf of the people once a year, while Jesus Christ also offered his life as the ultimate sacrifice for the sin of humanity once and for all. And the writer emphasized that the high priest's duty in the Mosaic covenant was just a shadow of the heavenly thing. If we go back to verse 5, it was just a shadow of the heavenly things in Hebrews 8, verse 5. It means Jesus is the mediator of the superior covenant as opposed to the inferior covenant. Jesus is the mediator of better promises in the new covenant as opposed to the broken promises of the Israelite in the old covenant. Now, let's focus now on verse 7. Hebrews 8, verse 7. "For if there had been nothing wrong with that first covenant, no place would have been sought for another." So what was wrong with the old covenant then? What made it inferior? I thought God is perfect. If God is perfect, why then he made something that is inferior? Let me tell you, God is perfect. There's nothing wrong with God. God will always be perfect. As James tells us in James 1:17, every good and perfect things are from above, coming down from the Father of light, with whom there's no variation or shadow of turning. There's nothing wrong with the covenant that God made with Moses. And there's no fault in it. So where was the fault? Where was the fault? Let's check from our passage in Hebrews 8. In verse 8 tells us, "But God found fault with the people." And jumping into verse 9b, it tells us that they did not remain faithful to my covenant. That's what was wrong with this covenant. It's not God, but the people. There's nothing wrong with God, but there is always something wrong with man. We saw it in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. Remember, God told them not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And what did they do? They exchanged their fellowship with God. They exchanged their eternal relationship with God with just a bite of that fruit. How about Abraham? Abraham, remember Abraham? Though he is a man of faith, and yet he also faltered. He lied about his wife Sarah when he went to Egypt, telling them that Sarah was her cousin. Okay, or a sister, I believe. Okay. And how about with Moses? With Moses. Remember Moses? He was instructed to command to the rock so that water will gush out. But instead, out of his anger with the people of Israel, he just struck the rock with his rod. And how about King David? King David was also a murderer, and he was also an adulterer. And all of the forefathers, that though they knew God and experienced his faithfulness, they still find ways to disobey, to rebel, and to sin against God. So there's nothing wrong with God, but there's always something wrong with man. But God, again, listen to this, but God, in his nature of love, but God, who is abounding in love, but God, who is slow to anger, continue to love, to protect, to provide, to heal, to guide, and lead his people. God always remembers his end of the deal with the covenant he made with Abraham. God is a promise-keeping God. God is a covenant-keeping God. So, what was wrong with the covenant that it's needed to be replaced? What was wrong with the old covenant that is needed to be replaced? It needs to be replaced because of what it cannot do and what it cannot provide. The old covenant demands righteousness, and yet people fell the more they fell into sinfulness. The old covenant demands obedience, and yet even more the people keeps on falling into rebellion. The old covenant cannot give or impart life. Instead, it leads to death. That's why Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 3:7-9. Listen to this. He said, the old covenant is a ministry of death and condemnation. That's how Paul called the old covenant, a ministry of death and condemnation. And here's to compare the old and new covenant that explains why it needs to be replaced. The old covenant is exclusive to the Jews, while the new is inclusive to all. The old covenant is a temporary covenant, while the new covenant is an eternal covenant. The old covenant brought bondage, while the new covenant sets us free. The old covenant brings curse. The new covenant brings blessing. The old covenant was a list of what we shall do. The new covenant is a list of what Christ has done. The old covenant tells us we are not good enough. The new covenant tells us Jesus is enough. And I think we can give him praise of thanksgiving to God. Earlier, I said that Mosaic law is synonymous to the Mosaic covenant, that we cannot separate the law from the covenant. Like the question we asked about the old covenant, is there something wrong with the Mosaic law? Is there something wrong with the Mosaic law? Let's check the Bible, what it tells about the law. Psalms 19:7-8. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. And then Paul wrote in Romans 7:12, he said, the law is holy, and the commandment holy, just, and good. So, there's nothing wrong that we can find with the law. But let's look at what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 3:6. He said, we are made sufficient as ministers of the new covenant, not better, not of the law, but of the Spirit, but of grace. For the letter or the law kills, but the Spirit gives life. Isn't it that Paul just said in Romans 7 to 12, the law is holy and the commandment holy, just and good. And now in 2 Corinthians telling us that the law kills. Was Paul contradicting what he said? Let me tell you, the old covenant law was given to point them to their sin and to lead people to the truth that they need Jesus Christ. Let me say that again. The old covenant law was given to point them to Israelite, to their sin, and to lead people to the truth that they need Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of the law. As Jesus said, I've come not to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. In this new covenant, God said, He will put the laws in our minds, and He will write them in our hearts, as Hebrews 10:8-10 says. Jesus is the new law in this new covenant. Brothers and sisters, as I said earlier, there's so much more to know and to learn about the covenants of God. We can extract many more preachings and studies about this theme, but for now, let me conclude by this. Many believers are still confused about the two covenants, the old and the new. Many are still asking this question. As a believer, am I still to adhere to the law of Moses? Am I supposed to be both old and new covenant person? Am I under grace or under the law? Or should I be a person of both grace, of grace plus the law? And there are those who are going back to the practice of Judaism. And as a review, what is Judaism? Judaism is the monotheistic religion of the Jews, and their obedience is to the Mosaic law. And as we read about Paul going up hard against the Judaizers of his time, and even to some apostles like Peter, who were showing some forms of legalism in front of some Jewish converts. Folks, brothers and sisters, let me tell you, if you are in Christ, you are a new creation. The old is gone and everything becomes new. And yes, even the old covenant in you is gone. You and I are new creation in Christ, the new covenant people of God, ratified by the precious blood of Jesus Christ and sealed by the Holy Spirit. It's either you are of the old or the new. Mixture is not acceptable to God. And I'm praying, I'm hoping that you will be the new covenant people of God in Christ Jesus. Next Sunday, we will be talking about the best part of this short series, the new covenant in my blood, as Jesus said. Let us pray. Hallelujah, Lord God. Lord, thank you, God, for today. Thank you for your message. Thank you for your word that you have spoken through me. And I pray, Lord, that whatever we have heard, including myself, including your people, oh God, Lord, will just keep it in their hearts. So God, ponder about the words that they have heard, especially with regards to the reason why you need to put away, oh God, the old covenant, and that the new covenant will come in, oh God, Lord. Father, Lord, in the name of Jesus, I pray, oh God, Lord, that, Lord, you will seal everything that we have heard today, oh God, Lord. And Lord, that we will continuously study your word and learn more about the old covenant and the new covenant, oh God. And Lord, we're looking forward for next Sunday as we will be talking about Jesus Christ, who is the author of this new covenant, oh God, Lord, in his blood. Again, Lord, thank you for today. And we give you all glory, honor, and praise. In your name we pray. Amen and amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Just give me a second to just catch up my breath. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So today, again, as a family of God, as a family of believers, we will come now in prayer. And as you notice, the last few Sundays, I've been asking family to lead a prayer. And today, I've asked the David family, Tito Arnel, Tita Tess, Diane, and Binbin, to lead us in prayer. So I'm giving the floor to the David family, and so that they can lead us in prayer. So to all of us who are listening, let's just continuously remain in the spirit of prayer and in agreement with the family we'll be praying for. Let's just believe by faith that God is not just a listening God, but God is also an answering God. Tito Arnel and family.
Thank you, Pastor Rick. Please join me in prayer. Prayer for the frontliners. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, the Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, through your Holy Spirit we come to you and ask you to grant our petitions that will please you and magnify you and glorify your holy name. First of all, Lord, we want to thank you for all the things you have done, especially your sacrifice on the cross. And because of that, you freed us, forgiven, and save us, and enjoying now the gift of eternal life. Again, Lord, we thank you for loving us and for your sufficient grace. Thank you for what you're doing and what you have about to do tomorrow and to the future, knowing and believing it is your will be done. Thank you for the great message you just gave us today. Thank you for your servant, our dear Pastor Rick. We pray that you will grant the desire of his heart and bless all the things that he's doing and about to do, and bless the whole family, Lord. Lord God, at this moment, I am praying and we are praying for our frontliners. I will not mention them one by one because you know them all. And you heard our prayer over and over again. But we will not get tired asking you, because to you alone we can come to ask you and ask our petition. Lord, as we pray for our frontliners all over the world, may you help them realize that there is someone, powerful God, in front of them. And that is you, Lord Jesus. Lord, it's been a long journey now for them, and some of them get tired, weary, and some of them run out of resources, especially those in poor countries like Philippines. May you grant them peace, provide their needs, and comfort them always, even their loved ones. May you remind them, Lord, even those who don't know you, that you are with them in this journey, no matter how long it is. Lord, we know that the front line is the most critical and dangerous position. And these people who are willing to sacrifice their life to go in front of us, they always face danger. They face every day different kinds and different difficult situations. So our prayer to you that you go in front of them to save them from danger and grant them strength every time. And this all be us to you, in you, on you, and from you, oh God. Those who are weary, those who are tired and burdened, may you grant them peace, Lord, and find rest in you. So, Lord Jesus, thank you that you are the one who is in front of them, protecting them and providing them their needs. So, Lord, thank you for your love and your grace. We ask this in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Brother Arnel. Tita Tess.
Let us pray for our government leaders, not only in Canada, but around the world. But, as we know, lots of things happening, mostly bad things that we hear and read. But let us just trust God that even though there are bad things, He will turn this into good for His purposes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Our Heavenly Father, O God, we praise you. We worship you, O God. We give you glory. We adore you, O God, for you are our sovereign God, O Lord, that you are in control, O God, Lord, of what's happening around us, O God. Lord, you are the Lord of lords, the King of kings, the leader of all leaders, O God, Lord. So now, O Father, we lift up to you all the leaders around the world, O God, Lord. These leaders, O God, Lord, that you have chosen, O God, Lord. We may see bad things and good things, O God, Lord. But, O God, you know, O God, Lord, although we see good things and bad things, O God, Lord, but we know, O God, Lord, that you have a purpose for it, O Father. Lord, right now we entrust them unto you, O Father. We ask, O God, Lord, that you give them wisdom, O God, Lord. Wisdom wisdom on how to rule, wisdom on how to lead the people, and wisdom on how to navigate this the current situation, oh God, Lord, in different countries, Lord, hallelujah, especially those who are greatly affected by the pandemic, and lately, Lord, in Beirut, Lebanon, oh Father, Lord, we entrust all these leaders unto you, Father, that they will inquire from you, oh God, Lord, for you alone, oh God, Lord, is the source of wisdom, perfect wisdom indeed, oh God, Lord, hallelujah, Lord, hallelujah, Lord, we ask that you will surround these people with godly people, oh God, Lord, that they will ask for godly counsel, O God, Lord, for we believe, O God, Lord, they cannot do it on their own, O God, Lord. For you said in your word, O Father, that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, O God, Lord. Hallelujah, we pray that they will fear you, O God, Lord, as they lead, O Father. And Lord, that they will put you first in their lives, O Father, and then the people that they are serving, O Lord, and that they will put behind their personal interests, O God. Hallelujah, Lord, we pray for their salvation also, O God, Lord. Hallelujah, and Lord, we entrust them unto your mighty hands, O God, that you will guide them and you will lead them every step of the way, O God, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord, we pray this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen, amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. So, who's next? I'm calling Binbin.
Yeah. So, I'm going to be praying for those affected by COVID-19. So let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us together today, for the opportunity to learn about you and worship you for who you are. We know that you are always with us and in our midst today. Lord, we praise you for who you are and thank you for what you have done for us in our daily lives. Today, I lift up those who have been directly affected by COVID-19. We know that you are a great physician and that there's nothing that is impossible for you. We pray for healing over those who have contracted the virus and that you contain the virus so that it doesn't spread to their loved ones. I pray that you continuously provide guidance and wisdom so that we can remain safe and avoid any further infections. I lift up those who have also been affected indirectly. I pray that you give them the strength and the faith to fully trust in you and your sovereign hand. I want to lift up those who have suffered in any way due to COVID-19 in terms of their occupation, their financial situation or business. I pray that you remind them that you are our provider and to fully trust in you for all of their needs. Everything that we have is yours, and everything we have we'll use for your glory, Lord God. So I pray that you help us to fully surrender our situations in light of the pandemic and to truly rely on you. I also want to pray for those who have lost loved ones due to the virus. It may be difficult to understand why these things may be happening, but I pray that you give those who are suffering the peace and comfort that they need to endure these difficult times. I pray that you comfort them with your love and that you give them hope for the future of the good that is to come. I pray that you remind them that your ways are perfect and that you are good all the time. In saying these things, I pray that you help us to continue looking to you, Lord Jesus, as our provider for all of our needs, and that our faith strengthens so that we can fully rely on you for everything. Thank you for your love and for your grace every day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you. Thank you, Ben, for your prayer. And last but not least, Diane.
Let's pray for a vaccine. So Lord, today we pray that during this time, as doctors and scientists work on finding a vaccine, that you would continue to guide them. I pray that you would give them the wisdom and the resources to be able to formulate the vaccine. We know, Lord, that you are in control and that in your time a vaccine will be made. And when that time comes, Lord, let there be unity among our leaders, governments, and healthcare systems to make the vaccine accessible, especially to those who can't afford proper healthcare. Lord, you are our ultimate healer, and with you, nothing is impossible. I pray that this pandemic will be a time that people desire to turn to you and to believe in you as their savior. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for all those prayers that has been said, Lord. And again, by faith, we believe, O God, Lord, in your perfect time, according to your will, O God, Lord, you will answer those, O God, Lord, and that there will be an end to this pandemic. There will be a provision for the vaccine. There will be protection and preservation and healing and provision for all the people who are directly or indirectly affected by this COVID-19. And even for our church family, I continue to lift up everyone of God, from the youngest to the oldest, male and female, especially our frontliners who are part of this BLF Christian Fellowship family, oh God, Lord, that day in and day out, they are continually serving, oh God, Lord. God, Lord, through their profession, through their workplace, oh God, Lord, not just in the hospital, not just in the long-term care system, but also in the factory, in the grocery store, oh God, Lord, and wherever they may be, being an essential worker, I pray for your continuous protection upon us. And Lord, even the families of BLR Christian Fellowship, you will continuously build us up, oh God, in faith and in trust, oh God, in you alone, oh God, Lord, that you are sovereign over our situation, that you're sovereign over this pandemic, oh God, Lord Jesus, oh God, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And now today, we lift up to you our some people who have been asking for prayer, oh God, for healing, oh God, Lord. Again, you are our Jehovah Rapha, our great physician, oh God, Lord. We pray for our dear sister Melly continuously for to strengthen her, to just heal her, oh God, the Lord. And we know, oh God, that the day will come when she will be totally, completely, wholly free from this sickness that she's been suffering from, oh God, for the longest while now, oh God. And Lord, by faith, we claim it, oh God, Lord. And that even as she is waiting for this answer, you are continuously strengthening her spirit, her faith in you, including her family, oh God, Lord. We also lift up to you our dear sister Annalyn, oh God, Annalyn Galarion, who's been still waiting for the next result of her biopsy. Thank you, first of all, for the first result of this biopsy that has been negative, oh God. We praise you for that. Indeed, Lord, it's an answer to our prayer. And now she's waiting for the second biopsy, oh God, Lord. the second MRI that's been done already. We pray, oh God, Lord, that it will also be negative, oh God, because you are an answering God, Lord, that with you nothing is impossible. That through this, oh God, the faith of the family, the Galarian family, even the people surrounding her, her relatives, her friends, oh God, Lord, her co-teachers will see, will experience the miracle of God through her. And again, thank you, oh God, for Mami Ninita also. She's not using her walker any longer. She can walk just by using a cane. And that's a miracle, oh God, from you, oh God. That's the work of your wonder in the life of Mami Ninita. And Lord, we expect the fullness of her health, oh God, that she will fully recover, oh God, Lord. And even as she is desiring now that she does not need any more further tests like the angiography, oh God, Lord. Lord, if it is your will for her not to do that anymore, then so be it according to her faith, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah. And even for Tate Frankie, we first of all thank you for his healing. And now he is at home recuperating. We just speak wellness and healing, full healing upon Tate Frankie, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah. Even so with the people who have some unspoken prayer requests for healing, provision, protection, preservation, oh God, Lord, we lift them up unto you, oh God, Lord Jesus. And we thank you again for today, oh God, Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for speaking to us your word of truth, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah. That indeed, Lord, we are no longer under the law, but we are now under the grace of Jesus Christ, oh God, Lord. That because we are in Christ Jesus, oh God, Lord, oh God, we already fulfilled the law. We fulfilled what is stipulated in the old covenant, oh God, Lord Jesus, oh God, Lord. And now we are the new covenant people of God in Christ Jesus, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah, oh God. Praise be to you, Jesus, oh God, Lord. Again, we just commit to you the rest of the day, oh God, Lord. The rest of our afternoon, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. And may the Lord make his face shine upon you. And may the Lord be gracious to you always. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and everyone said, Amen. Amen. God bless you all.